Hey guys, Tony KD at RTT. If you can't tell behind me, I'm at a very special place. That's the ARRL headquarters. I'm in Newington, Connecticut. I decided to take the weekend, take a trip up here, check it out. My goal, obviously, is to take a tour of the place and also operate W1AW. So if they let me, I want to record everything, get a recording of the entire tour, and then some footage of me actually operating. But it just got here, so I'm pretty excited. About to head inside. See you in a bit.
There are about 100 employees at ARRL. Most of them work here, some of them at the warehouse, and some of them at other places. A lot of these pictures here go from the 1920s. Of course, we have another picture of Barry Goldwater, one of our most famous hands. And then we come over here, we get a little history of ARRL. As I mentioned to Jim earlier, Hiram Percy Maxim, the founder of ARRL, was an automotive engineer, and he had a job in Hartford, so that's why we're in Hartford.
Okay.
So we originally, in the 1920s, were in Hartford. There's a picture from here, and then 25. Then there was a big flood. We had our antennas and our stations down at Brainerd Field, which is an airport, still exists in Hartford, but they got flooded out in the early 30s. And they moved in 1931 to West Hartford. And they stayed there. This is about 63 LaSalle Road. There's an alley here. Well, I grew up in Northern Illinois, and I got my license in 1953. And so I thought West Hartford was the center of the universe, because that's where ARRL is. I got a job in Bloomfield, Connecticut in 1964. Came from the Midwest, got my job. Connecticut. So the first thing I did is I went to West Hartford to see the ARRL headquarters. Because in 1963, they built this building on this land. This land is 19 acres. They originally bought the land when in the 1930s when they got washed out back in Hartford at Brainerd Field. So they built this land. They built W1AW. It was actually completed in 37 or 38, and all of this was Rombuck antennas and all kinds of other antennas until 19. This is all prairie, all pasture land. So then they built this building in 63, and they added the addition in 78. So this is a historical history of the different places that ARRL was located.
I thought there was another place before here, because I remember. You know Don Search?
No.
Don Search used to be like the Bill Moore back again. And 2 years ago when we were here for the centennial, we went looking for his old house.
Uh-huh.
And then there was some place, I want to say it was more towards downtown, going to me. He said, oh, well, that's where it used to be before we moved out here.
This is the display they had. If there are other places, there could be, but I'm...
It could be a transitional place, too.
Yeah.
And like you said, there are people that are working off-site from here. Now that might have been where he was at.
This building at 63 LaSalle Road, it turned out across this alley at 65 LaSalle Road, I worked there 30 years. 10 years in Bloomfield, 30 years on LaSalle Road,
wow.
Right where ARRL used to be. Now I'm going to show you the most popular room in the whole place. This is the QSL outfield.
This is where the real thing is.
This is the real
because
stuff.
Because I saw
here.
The little setup area 2 years ago, so, and I wondered where the real spot was.
So if you have a contact with somebody in Minnesota and you want to swap QSL cards, you take your card, penny postcard or whatever it costs. I forgot what it is now. How much? How much is a postcard in the United States? 10 cents?
I don't know. I usually got to stuff in an envelope with another envelope and return postage. So,
But it's economical, so you can do that. But if you're going to send one to Germany or Japan or Cuba or North Korea, it's more complicated and much more expensive. So there, we have a bureau here, and you would send your cards here. And then they would be sent out in boxes like this. If they're going to North Korea or they're going to Cuba, they have to go through, Cuba they go through Spain, And North Korea, I don't know how they get through there, but for all the other countries, the 250 countries, roughly, 225, whatever it is, they would come in here, they get sorted like in the old mailboxes they had in the last 19th century, you know. They put these things together, and the young lady who runs this place, who is a ham, Roseanne and her husband volunteers, he's retired, and they either work in front of their TV set or they work here, and they put them in the boxes. Each box is for a different country. The more popular countries, England and Germany and so on,
get a bigger
much
box.
Bigger boxes, and the less popular ones you can see here. And when they're filled up, then they get mailed out by private mail, whatever the least expensive thing is. If you look over on this board, Roseanne very carefully has kept track. And here she has it in weight, okay, what she shipped. And here she has it, and also showing the number of cards.
Wow.
That are shipped. This happens to be for this year that she's doing. So this is a real popular room whenever I take a tour. But you see all these cards. And so that the QSL cards are not dead, even though we have Logbook of the World. They're very much still popular. And the popularity varies by time of the year. And if you look at these numbers, you'll see here in September or October, you're down at 202. And then you come up, look at that, in December, 445. And then here, it varies by month. Depends on when hams get around to operating and sending in their cards.
I usually wind up sending them like first of the year, so yeah, it doesn't surprise me. That's what the spike is.
Okay, thank you, Roseanne.
Thanks.
You're filming.
In here is a warehouse area. This used to be the main warehouse area, but now they have a building about a quarter of a mile or so away. Here, W1AW, all these antennas hook into W1AW for the members. So we'll head over here. We have security, of course, because of it being an imperfect world. Now that fence there, that white fence, behind that white fence are emergency generators. And those are tested periodically, because if you don't test emergency generators periodically, you just may find you've got some big gold brick there when you need it. All the antennas here are considered commercial grade, so that they're all insured as a commercial radio station. The maintenance work that's done on this is done by professionals, not done by ham radio operators. That's required by the insurance that they have. Right? Got that right, Steve?
Yeah.
Well, Steve does not climb up there.
I wouldn't do that anyway.
Although I'm sure he would love to climb up there.
I don't climb, I just lower my total down. Like,
thank you.
Okay. We'll stop here a second. And here is old Betsy.
Oh, right. Let's see it go.
Right here. We would love to see it operate.
Oh, okay. Well, I'm just going to clean off the contacts here so we can get it.
And this was what Hiram Percy Maxim used. This is the original old Betsy. Most of the components that are here are original, but not all of them. And there are little brushes that he has, he's cleaning, but there's a wheel that spins around, and of course it throws out RF at all kinds of frequencies, and it also makes a huge amount of noise, as you will hear, and that's why Hiram Percy Maxim kept it in the basement, and he operated it from his living room. And the CW, of course. They transmitted on all kinds of frequencies. We have no idea what frequencies he was transmitting on. They weren't up to that yet. That came later. 1912. That's good. Thank you. 1912 to 14. You can take pictures of it if you wish. And this desk over here was Hiram Percy Maxim's desk. This was donated. As much of his stuff was donated here to ARRL.
Do y'all don't have to lube the bearings anymore?
He does lubricate. Those are for lubrication. That's right.
I know what those are for.
He uses another method. I don't think Joe.
He's probably using something more modern now. But
yeah. I think he goes in with an oil can or something.
Probably,
yeah. Yeah. Yeah, but that's the way it was originally.
I noticed they were empty and I was like, I don't try to burn that poor thing up. It should last for 100 years.
Now, this station was finished in 1938. It's been remodeled several times. It has air conditioning now. Over here, you see the equipment that's used for code practice and for bulletins. And if you walk in over here, you'll see this is the patch panel. All the antennas that are outside are all patched in through this patch panel. If you turn around here, you'll see this equipment. It looks very old. And the reason it looks very old is it is very old. And can anybody tell me what this is, this old thing? You know what that is?
Yeah, it's a computer.
it's an old compact computer, okay? And you see the floppy little holes for the floppy disk?
Mm-hmm.
I actually used to have one of those drives, the CD-ROM drives.
Well, you see in there on those floppies?
Oh my God.
That's for code practice.
Now, wow.
Are you using code practice from 20 years ago or more? The answer is code practice hasn't changed. And as long as this thing keeps humming, they broke, don't fix it, right?
Yeah.
And so all this old equipment is still working. The equipment over here has changed. You'll see the racks say Harris on them. There's not much Harris equipment left in here, but the racks remain. Most of the equipment you see in here that is not Harris equipment. It's newer equipment that has gone in, but the racks, like the compacts, still keep humming. So they continue to use the racks.
Well, the racks ain't changed in years. They still, what is it, EIA 318 or something they're based off of. I've done some test equipment back in my days. So I've had the rack mount a bunch of stuff.
Okay, now in here we have different rooms, transmit stations. And you can operate in any of these rooms and any piece of equipment. We actually have people come in here who are interested in buying new equipment, and they'll try out the equipment that's here, because then they go, they'll have experience with it and see if that really works for them. And this gentleman is operating now. Of course, you operate as W1AW. And then you can tell what your call is, but you are W1AW and you operate here. Okay, so are either one of you interested in operating or both?
Yep.
Okay.
CQ, CQ, CQ. Hello, CQ, CQ, CQ. This is Whiskey 1, Alpha Whiskey. Whiskey 1, Alpha Whiskey, W1AW. Calling CQ, CQ, CQ. Whiskey 1, Alpha Whiskey. Whiskey 1, Alpha Whiskey. Calling CQ, CQ, and standing by. W2 Alpha India Victor, you are 5757, Newington, Connecticut.
Yeah, very good, thank you. W1AW, W2AIV, you're 5-9 North Carolina.
All right, thanks for the 5-9 in North Carolina. The name here is Tony. My personal call is KD8RTT, that is Kilo Delta 8, Romeo Tango Tango. All right, sorry about that. Yeah, my foot slipped off the switch. The call here, the personal call is Kilo Delta 8 Romeo Tango Tango. Just operating here, visiting at ARRL headquarters. So thanks for the contact in 73. This is Whiskey 1 Alpha Whiskey.
Yeah, very good, Tony.
Kilo 4, Charlie Lima Yankee.
I did it myself several decades ago. It's probably been early 90s or late 80s. It's been a long time since I came through and sat down to mic up there. You have a good day, 73, W1AW, W2AIV.
All right, very good. Yep, thanks for the contact. It's my first time up here, so it's pretty cool to operate. 73's, Whiskey 1 Alpha Whiskey. I think I heard Kilo Kilo 4 Charlie Lima Yankee.
QSO, QSO, you're 5'9 plus in North Carolina. The name is Garner. Golf Alpha Romeo, November Echo Romeo, Garner.
All right, Garner, I got you 5'9 also here up in Newington, Connecticut. The name here is Tony, Tango Oscar, November Yankee. And my personal call is Kilo Delta 8, Romeo Tango Tango.
Okay, thanks. Sound good. 73.
All right, 73. Thanks. QRZ, Whiskey 1, Alpha Whiskey.
Whiskey 4, Kilo Foxtrot, Foxtrot.
Whiskey 4 station, I think it was Kilo Foxtrot, Foxtrot.
You got it, Tony. It's Whiskey 4, Kilo Foxtrot, Foxtrot. You are 5'9 into Western North Carolina. Name is Ken.
All right, Ken, thanks for the 5'9. You are also 5'9 up here into Connecticut. You got my name. Name's Tony. And my personal call is Kilo Delta 8, Romeo Tango Tango.
Roger, roger. Got it. And enjoy your stay at the home office. I've been there a couple times. It's quite an experience if you've never been there before. It's say hello to John for me, and you have a great day. Enjoy your stay there.
All right, very good. Yep, it's my first time here, so trying to appreciate it. I got to finish the tour a little later, so looking forward to that. The 73, thanks. Whiskey 1, Alpha Whiskey.
Zulu
Zulu station?
QSL call is Whiskey Alpha 4, Zulu Zulu. Name here is Tim, Tango India Mike. I'm in the state of Tennessee. And you're 59, obviously 59 coming in this morning, Tony.
All right, Whiskey Alpha 4, Zulu Zulu. Thanks, Tim. You are also 59. Nice to make the contact with Tennessee.
QSL, hey, thank you for being there and have fun. Maybe one of these days I'll be able to sit in your seat there. You have a good day. 73, Tony. Whiskey 1 Alpha Whiskey. Whiskey Alpha 4 Zulu Zulu. 73.
73 to you, too. Thanks for the contact. Whiskey 1 Alpha Whiskey. QRZ.
This is the lobby, and we have here all of the books that are published by ARRL. They're available here, or they're available online on the website. And if you have any questions about them and the pricing, you can check with the receptionist. We also have a line of clothing. At the moment, they're featuring the National Park Service. 100th anniversary is this year, and there's a tie-in. Ham Radio is tying in with that, and with contests for people operating from the different national parks. And we have a line of knickknacks here as well. Okay, let's head right to the building.
Here they are.
This area, the staff here service the service. There were over 2,000 clubs that were associated with ARRL around the United States, and so if a club has questions about getting insurance, or bylaws, or constitution, they can get help here, as well as other questions they might have about field day or other activities that they're doing.
Okay.
Now they have on display here some emergency kits. This is a handheld kit, and that is a high frequency kit. You can see the antenna up there that they've put up, and these kits are shipped anywhere in the world where there is a need for emergency communications. In the United States, our emergencies vary by section of the country. So on the West Coast, it's forest fires.
Mm-hmm.
In the North, it's ice storms. In the Midwest, it's tornadoes.
Right.
East Coast, hurricanes. For the most part, in the United States, when there's a problem like an ice storm in Connecticut, then there will be hams come from surrounding communities to relieve the first responders, the police and fire, to provide communications between the shelters like gymnasiums and schools to the hospitals and to the first responders for the few days, the few weeks that might be needed. Sometimes, like in New Orleans, when we had the New Orleans event, the hurricane down there, then this equipment was sent there.
Okay.
And this equipment was also sent to Haiti when they had their problem. And if you look around the corner here,
oh wow,
all these kits are ready to go. They're periodically opened up and checked to make sure everything is still in good order, and then shipped out as needed. Your membership dollars at work,
right?
Okay. We'll head across the hall here. going to go in here, but it's in this area where the awards are handled. We used to do primarily QSL cards, but now logbook of the world, so everything is done electronically. Mm-hmm. So when you would qualify for work to all states or something, then they would print out a certificate. The certificate would be put in the snail mail and mailed to you, and then you could get it framed and put up on your wall. So it's a combination of yesterday's ham radio with QSL cards and today's modern means of communication. We have about 100 employees with ARRL, so and over 160,000 dues-paying members. So it's a corporation.
Yeah.
Everybody has a computer on their desk. Everything's tied together by computers.
Okay. So
you get this combo yesterday and today.
Are all employees, or you said there's some employees who aren't, who don't work here at this specific place?
There's some remote. There's a warehouse, which is within a mile of here, and there are other hams employees in different parts of the country. I'm not quite sure
about
the state, but I think most are here, about 100 employees.
Okay.
Let's go through a little history.
All right.
So we have Faraday in 1831. We have Samuel Morse in 1838 and his code.
Right.
Did you see the movie Lincoln?
No.
Okay, well, they did a movie Lincoln recently within the last 5 years. And it showed Lincoln going to the telegraph office to check up on what was going on in the front lines, the battlefield of the Civil War.
Mm-hmm.
Civil War is 1861 to 1865. So at that period, Morse code and telegraph was well established in the modern world, if you will. So in Europe and in England and the United States, by the turn of the century, by 1900, there were cables underneath the Atlantic Ocean connecting Europe with the United States and with England with the United States and England with Europe. So you had instant communications. If something happened in Chicago, they knew about it in Paris virtually instantly because of Morse code and because of those cables. So there's no real interest in wireless except for two groups, the German Navy and the British Navy. Because when their ships were out of sight of land, then they didn't have communication.
Mm-hmm.
So that was the main interest. It wasn't an interest for communications other than that at that time.
Okay.
So here we are in the 1880s, and we get into Hertz. Hertz was, and Maxwell were working with electromagnetic stuff. And there were experiments going on, and in England they were holding seminars where they discussed this among mathematicians and engineers. Over in Italy, this fellow here, Guglielmo Marconi, the son of a very wealthy family, was an experimenter, and he was interested in this sort of thing. So he asked his family if it's okay if he went over to England and observed these seminars, and they said sure. So he goes over there, and he was the Bill Gates, Steve Jobs of the day.
Okay.
He saw what these guys didn't see. So he was not a mathematician, he was not a physicist, he didn't work with formulas. They did.
Mm-hmm.
He saw what they didn't see, the practical use.
Okay.
And he developed the wireless radio. And he experimented. He didn't know whether there should be antennas of what length. Should they be horizontal? Should they be vertical? Do you get a different effect if you transmit at the sea level or on top of a mountain? Does it matter at nighttime or daytime? To make a long story short, he figured all that out.
Okay.
If you want to read a book on how he did that, there's a historical novel, which was a bestseller in the New York Times bestseller list just within the last 5 years. It's called Thunderstruck by Eric Larson. Eric Larson is a very well-known historical novelist. He's got two or three books on the New York Times bestseller list at this time. And this book is available from Barnes & Noble or from Amazon.
Okay.
And I recommend it to you. And it tells you all about how Marconi developed the wireless.
Okay.
He had installed on many passenger ships what were called Marconi stations. And those are for the convenience of the passengers. And they operated during daylight hours, and they would send messages back to England or to France or the States about what the passengers were doing or what's going on at home.
Okay.
Okay, but just during daylight hours. Then in 1912, in the nighttime, the Titanic hits an iceberg. There are ships in the area who could have rescued the passengers, but their Marconi stations were shut down because they didn't operate at night. It was just for the convenience of the passengers. So after 1912, then Marconi stations became very popular on commercial ships, and they were operated 24/7. And of course, the British Navy and the German Navy had their wireless.
Right.
Okay. We move along here, and we get to this period. Here's old Betsy,
which
you saw over at W1AW. The history goes something like this. Hiram Percy Maxim's an MIT grad, gets a job with an automobile manufacturing company in Hartford. Okay? He had a teenage son. Teenage son got a crystal set, couldn't make it work. Goes to his dad.
Mm-hmm.
Father and son are bonding. Hiram Percy Maxim, the father, couldn't make it work either. So he gets the manufacturer who was in the area to come, and they figured it out and made it work. That hooked Hiram Percy Maxim on amateur radio.
Okay.
So he builds old Betsy. And when he operated it, and his house is still here in Hartford, when he operated it, any other stations in the area couldn't be operating at the same time. They had to be on different schedules because they interfered with each other.
Right.
And it turns out these things didn't broadcast that far. So if you wanted to get a message to somebody in Washington, D.C., you would have to relay it, okay, and then they would relay it. And so when they came to form an organization, the name they gave it was the American Radio Relay League.
Okay.
That's what
they
named
it. Yeah.
Okay. So that's the history of how things got going. Now, after old Betsy, and there was a fellow named Edwin Armstrong, who these plaques really don't give much time to, but Armstrong was a student at Columbia University, and he developed the regenerative circuit, and then the super regenerative, and the super height, super
heterodyne.
Okay, and what that did was it allowed you to magnify the sound hundreds of times, so you didn't have to use headphones, you could use speakers. And now you can magnify voice, and you can magnify music, and this was a major breakthrough. He licensed that to a guy named David Sarnoff, who was the president of the Radio Corporation of America. And they then subsequently licensed it to other manufacturers.
Okay.
Edwin Armstrong was an inventor. And so he continued to invent, and he goes to Sarnoff. He says, I got this new deal. Instead of amplitude modulation, which is what you've been using, with frequency modulation, much better.
Mm-hmm.
Okay? Sarnoff says to Armstrong, we have a monopoly with amplitude modulation. We're not going to ruin our monopoly, so we're not interested in frequency modulation. All right? Make a long, complicated story short, there was a lawsuit between RCA and Armstrong. It expended physically and financially Armstrong's resources, and he committed suicide in 1953, jumped off a building in New York City. His wife was more forgiving, and she settled with Sarnoff for $1 million in 1954. FM did not get going because of Sarnoff squelching it. until it really started in the late 1960s, but into the 1970s, before you had FM radio, because Sarnoff kept it down, and AM was the main method of communication.
Gather out there.
Hey.
Hi.
Okay, we move forward. There's a picture of him. And we get into the 1930s and 40s. They put all this stuff up for the 100th anniversary in 2014. Okay. And we get into the 1940s and 50s, and here's a typical vacuum tube. Now, when I got my license in 1953, I lived in Northern Illinois, and I remember going to a ham radio club meeting, and there was a guy there who gave a talk on a new invention called the transistor. And he said it was very interesting and had a number of interesting potentials, but it would never replace the vacuum tube because it was low voltage. And maybe that voltage would work for the filaments, but it would never work for the high voltage that you needed for the vacuum tube. So then we move forward and we get into the space age, and all the astronauts are ham radio operators, I'm told. And then we get the hams got involved in 1961, and this is a depiction of Oscar, the first amateur radio satellite. It was up for about 22 days, circled the Earth, and then it burned up in the atmosphere. They built two others of these. One is in the Smithsonian Institution, and the third one is here, and I'll show it to you in a few minutes.
Okay.
All right?
Cool.
So there's Barry Goldwater, one of our most famous amateur radio operators, who is a senator from Arizona, also a candidate for President of the United States. He was particularly known for being active during the Vietnam War, relaying messages from families in Vietnam to the United States and back to military, U.S. military. So we move up through that period, and we get the Logbook of the World, which started early in the 21st century. And so now we have the use of the internet and the use of modern communications tying in with ham radio operators so that you could register your communications with other hams without using QSL cards. Now we get to the latest period, and I watched all of this because I was I've been volunteering as a tour guide since before then. But they wanted to put QST, the magazine, on people's laptops or on their desktop computers. And they hired an outside outfit to help them, and they developed this. So then they had QST. So you didn't have to have the magazine in your hands. You could look at it on your iPad, or you could look at it on your laptop. And then somebody said, well, now, is there something more we can do? Because now we have QST on the computer, and the answer is yes. And now if you look at QST on your laptop or your iPad, there are links linking you to videos, linking you to other websites, and now QST is more of an educational and resource tool on the laptop or iPad than it is in just in a paper form. So developing and using the electronics that's available. This is a display of amateur radio in education. The ARRL has a foundation that funds the work to promote the use of ham radio in education. And there are seminars they call Teacher Institute, which are held here and in the Midwest and on the West Coast, depending, usually a couple a year, where for free, high school teachers, math and physics, can come and learn how they can use amateur radio to get girls and boys interested in the STEM subjects. And so this is a little display here advertising. And teachers can sign up through the website and attend these sessions. Here's a display of cartoons, the Gill cartoons. Gill did this for 37 years, and I remember when I was growing up in Northern Illinois, when I was a teenager, I'd get my QST, and I would see a cartoon like this one, Santa took you seriously, Jeeves. It's your 160-meter rhombic. And then I get out my handbook and look up what a rhombic was. And so it was an educational tool that I personally used. Mm-hmm. And it's been very popular. And you can actually, we have a book that's for sale in the lobby, which has all his cartoons in it. Now down here is where QST and the other publications are put together. The production area in here would be handled the editing of the text, and in the graphics area would be the handling of your schematics or whatever. So if you wanted to write an article and submit the article, mm-hmm. and maybe you had a schematic on a napkin and you submit that, they would turn it into a professional document that, you know, met the standards of publication. Okay. And then when the QST issue is ready, they would electronically send it to R.R. Donnelly, to one of their offices in the Chicago area, where it is printed and mailed directly to the 160,000 plus dues-paying members, so it doesn't come back here. Other publications, depending on the publications, are either done by Donnelly or they're done by other printers, and there is a warehouse that's within a mile of here where they're stored and mailed out of.
Okay.
It's a broadcast where they do videos, which are tied into QST or whatever. Hi, excuse this again. This is the employee station. Most of the employees are licensed ham radio operators. They either got their license before they came here or they got their license after they got here. And of course, the employees are all encouraged to get licenses. Mm-hmm. Liz, who's the receptionist, has an extra class license.
Okay.
Because they can understand the members' needs and questions and so on better if they're actually members themselves and involved in ham radio. And this is the station they can use, the employees can use. They don't use W1AW, so they can use this in their private time or they can use it work-related.
Okay.
Of course, they're going to have trouble operating if W1AW is operating.
Right.
Because of the kilowatt over there and you like 100 watts here or less. So anyway, all the antennas over the building come in through this patch panel.
Okay.
And all the antennas across the parking lot go through the patch panel over there to W1AW, so they're separate.
Okay. What's the call of this station?
HQ, W1HQ.
Oh, okay. Gotcha. Cool.
Good. All right, excuse us. Thank you. This is closed. This is a Faraday cage. When the door is closed, there's a metal floor as well. Then you're sealed off and no RF can get in or get out. And they do testing in here of equipment. They'll go to a retailer. They don't go to the manufacturer. They buy from the retailer so that the manufacturer doesn't know they're buying the equipment, so they don't get a souped-up version.
Right.
And then they'll take it in here and they'll test it. And then they will draft up a report, which they'll send to the manufacturer and say, these are all things we found wrong with the equipment. What are you going to do about it? And then after they would agree on what they were going to do and everything, and it gets published in QST.
Okay.
And they have over $100,000 worth of test equipment in here, which they recalibrate annually for these tests. This is our little museum we put together. This is a typical novice station from the 1960s and a typical AM station from a similar period. And people come through here, old-timers, and they immediately see the Heathkit equipment. Oh, I had that, and all that stuff. And here's a Helicrafters exhibit. And then here is a CW exhibit. So you see the old spark gap here.
Yep.
And then over on this side, we have all kinds of equipment here. And going in chronological order, going up here, and almost everybody had one version or another of the Helicrafters S-38. I had an S-38C.
Okay.
It was very popular, it was inexpensive radio, and when I was a teenager, I had one of those. But now, you being a ham, I'm going to give you a quiz.
Okay.
All right, you ready?
Yep.
Okay. Looking at this equipment here,
Which of this these are pieces of equipment do you think were manufactured before World War II, and which manufactured after World War II? Just by taking a look at something obvious I'm looking for, and includes that stuff down there too.
Okay. Let's see. I think I know that the whole Cycles versus Hertz, but I don't know when that. I think that was later.
No, that's not what I'm looking for. Something, okay. Something physical. Something obvious physical.
Hmm.
Okay, I'll tell you what it is.
Okay.
The boxes in wood boxes, receivers and transmitters in wood boxes, were probably manufactured before World War II.
Okay.
And the ones in metal boxes were probably manufactured after World War II. And the reason for that is television. There was no television before World War II. It had been invented, but it was not commercially spread throughout the country. Our family got our first Dumont TV set about 1950. Well, ham radio operators didn't have to worry about interference until television came along.
Okay.
And then you've got your, you know, you've got your interference coming up through the receivers and the transmitters going into your own home TV, not to mention your neighbors.
Right.
So hams called ARRL. And they say, I got a problem. My neighbors are complaining. My mother's complaining. My father's complaining of interference. And what the engineers here did was they got the hams to put their receivers and transmitters in metal boxes and ground those metal boxes. And they got the TV sets to do the same thing.
Okay.
Okay. Now, true Makes story. Sense. 1953. I'm a ham radio operator. In my left hand, I have my microphone. Okay. But it's getting to be dusk. So I want to turn the lights. So I go over to the light switch, and it was similar to this, had a metal panel here. Got my microphone in my left hand, I'm talking to somebody. I go with my right hand and I flick the switch, and one of my fingers hits the metal. Okay, I wake up sometime later, okay, because I've had electricity go through my whole body, 15, 16 years old. I'm out cold. I don't know how long I was out for. So after I awakened and I survived, I would not survive now, of course, but I looked into it and said, but I don't know what's going on here, because my receiver was in a metal box, my transmitter was in a metal box, the two of them were connected. I had a wire that ran outside the house down to the stake in the ground. And the answer was that the electrical system, the house was built about 1933, two wires, okay? Three-wire code didn't come in until about 1972.
Okay.
Okay. So the message to you is that not only do you want your receiver and transmitter tied together and to a stake outside onto the ground, but you want to make sure that your electrical system, that three-wire electrical system, that ground wire is in fact going, has been hooked up and is going outside to the same ground level as you, so that you have one common ground. Okay, here is our Oscar one. You can take that. And here you see it open. The one at Smithsonian is not open.
Okay.
Okay. And this explains all about it. It was up for 22 days, 145 megahertz. This is what you heard. So HI over and over again. We'll turn this off so we don't drive people crazy. But it was a secret because it was going up there with CIA satellites. It was, went up on top of a Thor rocket. And it cost $68. So if you look in there, that's $68 worth of stuff.
Wow.
In 1961 dollars.
Wow, I didn't know there were satellites, ham satellites up that.
Yeah, that was
early.
The first one. Yeah, wow. 61. Okay, let's go over here. This is D-Star. You know what D-Star is?
Yep.
Okay, so here's a D-Star setup that ARRL got so they could study the advantages and disadvantages of a very popular means of communication, the digital means of communication. It's popular with emergency services, firemen and policemen, because the signals are so excellent. The problem, the one problem we know about in particular is either you hear it or you don't.
Mm-hmm.
It's not unlike the other methods of communication where it fades out. Here, it cuts off. If you look behind here, you can see the patch panel for the antennas.
Yep.
And it's also hooked into the internet.
Okay.
Okay. Now, if you have problems of a electronic means, you can call ARRL, no, we're sure down the lab, could help you out.
Okay.
One ham, who was in charge of a factory, electronic equipment, all the equipment in the factory, electronic equipment he was in charge of, and the owner of the factory decided he was going to replace all his fluorescent bulbs with LED bulbs.
Mm-hmm.
So he put in all LED bulbs, and none of the electronic equipment would work. So this guy who was a ham, the guy who was in charge of all the equipment, he contacted the lab. The lab went to Lowe's and Home Depot, and they got samples of all the different bulbs that they sold, LED bulbs they sold. They brought them into this room here. And this equipment over here was used to check and see whether the bulbs met the FCC standards. And they found the ones that didn't, and the ones he was using were ones that didn't meet the standards. He swapped out for bulbs that did meet the standards, and everything was okay. So, and then there was an article published in QST about their studies. Of course, that's, even with fluorescent bulbs, there are ballasts back there, and they can make noise. So those have to meet FCC standards as well. So that's your membership dollars at work. Again, if you have a problem, you can call and get support from the lab here, and they do, they've done other testing and other things. They have been involved in giving testimony on internet over power lines,
okay,
at both the federal, state, and local levels, and gone out and done experiments with different groups that are either promoting internet over power lines or are trying to squash it, to show what the issues are,
mm-hmm,
and in determining whether or not internet over power lines should go forward, because there are, as you know, a number of advantages to doing that. But this is the engineering area, and as we've discussed originally, this building was built in 1963, and so these labs, well, they've been updated. In some ways, they still have equipment going back at that time. If you look in here, okay, turn this light on. They've redone that, but you'll see there are lathes in there.
Oh, yeah, wow.
You see all kinds of old equipment that they used to use this equipment for building, different building antennas and building all sorts of stuff. Towers and so on, where they did a lot of work back there.
Wow.
Well, that's sort of the story here. I'll show you this. This display here, I like this piece of equipment because it's a Flex 5000C,
mm-hmm,
and the 5000 is what it costs, $5,000. And they have two versions. They have a version, this is a transceiver, they have a version with a computer built into it, and then they have a version without. But on this screen here, this happens to be 1080. That's the main AM local 50,000 watt station. And you can see the sidebands. And if one of the engineers were to explain, they would explain what these different things are. But they can do that with any frequency and analyze it. And so that's sort of our story.
Wow.
All right, guys, so that's it for the tour. Hope you enjoyed it. I know the camera footage wasn't optimal. I was using my GoPro, so, you know, I was kind of hand-holding it on a small tripod, so it wasn't great, and it was shaky, and it wasn't aimed at the greatest, and the audio probably wasn't that great. I've already edited some of it, so sorry about that. But hope you enjoyed it. If you haven't seen the ARRL, hopefully that gave you kind of an insight to it. Like I said, I operated a while more, had a huge pileup going, just didn't think I'd put in all my operation time in the video, but
that was really cool. W1AW is definitely a cool little shack, and definitely worth checking out. I also want to say thanks to Dan, W1CNI, who was my tour guide. He was a really cool guy, really knowledgeable. After the tour, I stuck around for a bit, and we chatted for a while about you know, our backgrounds in ham radio and that sort of thing. And it was really cool to meet him. Everybody I met at ARRL was really nice, and you know, really just glad to share the history and everything that's there. So hopefully you guys enjoyed that. I've got some other videos in the works right now, so I was making a quick trip up here, thought I'd record it and share it with you guys. So please remember to like, subscribe, and go ahead and follow me on Twitter at KD8RTT, and we'll see you later. 73.